Hi everyone, can you hear me? Yeah, everybody can hear me well? Okay, great. So yeah, I'm Laura Verheecke. I work for Corporate Europe Observatory. Any of you have heard about this before? Yes? Okay, some people do. Okay, good. We're based in Brussels. We're an NGO of 13 people, and we look at lobbying in Brussels. We were created 15 years ago by a Dutch journalist. They wrote a book called Europe Inc. He got pretty famous. A film was made, Brussels Business. And then rich individuals came to us and asked us to keep working. So then we created this NGO. We're now based in Brussels. We work on lobbying in general. So we want the European Union to have more rules, more transparency. We're not against lobbying or against the European Union. We just believe that it's not transparent enough. And so that's what we ask for, you know, rules, ethics, and transparency. We work on four main themes: on trade, climate, agriculture, and finance. And I work on trade, that's why I'm going to talk about, ISDS. Anybody's heard about ISDS before? What does it stand for? Okay, Investor State Dispute Settlement. So it's a mechanism when you have an investor, a foreign investor and a state that have a dispute. And it's part of two agreements. One is CETA. And one is TTIP. CETA is the Comprehensive Economic Trade Agreement. It's a trade deal between the European Union and Canada. And TTIP is a trade deal between the European Union and the United States of America. Basically. That's what I will talk about today. If you don't understand my English, tell me. If you don't understand anything I say, please tell me. And if you have any questions along the way, because it's not clear enough, please tell me. I love this theme. Sometimes I get too much into details or too much acronyms, so please stop me if I'm starting to be unclear. So that's what I'll cover today, and then I understand we'll have a debate afterwards. So that's what I was saying. Basically, are you all from the European Union? No. Okay. The European Union is a crazy machine. there's three institutions mainly in the European Union. There's the Commission, the Parliament, and the Council. Some laws happen only in Brussels for the entire 28 member states. Some laws happen only in national capitals, so it will be only in Paris, only in Berlin. And some laws happen between Brussels and national capitals. On trade, especially on investment, since the Lisbon Treaty, this is something that we called a sole competence of the European Union, meaning it's only Brussels now that deals with investment. So Netherlands shouldn't be able to sign a treaty agreement with Indonesia anymore. Or Poland cannot sign with Ecuador anymore. It's the European Union now that signs investment treatment. That's why now we have all this treaty coming up at the European Union level. The first one, the big one, because there's obviously other ones, but I want to focus on the two main ones, is CETA. CETA is, negotiations with CETA is over, so we have the text now. It's been legally scrubbed, so we are, lawyers are looking at whether it corresponds to the Canadian constitutions and the European Union law. So it was finished in September 2014, and now they're scrubbing it, as we say in Europe. And TTIP negotiations are not finished. And basically, there's a lot of controversies about those trade deals, mainly because it's not actually really about trade. We only have 3% of tariffs between the European Union and the United States, meaning that most products and services that are traded among the two blocs actually are traded with little taxes on them, except for agriculture or textile. We actually trade a lot. So it's not really about tariff, like trade agreement used to be. Now it's all about institutions as well. So it creates regulatory cooperation, for instance, and it also asks for privatization of public services. And it also has, so ISDS, Investor State Dispute Settlement. That's what I was saying here. So the United States invests 1.5 billion euros in the European Union, so you can imagine that's quite a lot of money. One of the rationale between ISDS is if you have those kinds of mechanisms, you're going to have more foreign direct investment. There are actually countries that have a lot of foreign direct investment that don't have ISDS. And here the best example is Brazil. They never sign any deals. BITs is bilateral investment treaties. So when you have two countries signing an investment treaty. Brazil signed some investment treaties, but never with ISDS. And you can see from that CIA figures the amount of money they receive of foreign direct investment. So we don't actually need ISDS to have foreign direct investment. So there's no real rationale behind it. And my argument during the presentation will be that it's actually more of a threat to democracy than an incentive for investment. So what is it? What are we talking about? Can you see the picture well? Yeah? So you have here an investor. It's a foreign investor most of the time. It's not something that's available to national investor. It has to be a foreign investor. So it's a foreign investor that puts a claim in an international forum, a private international forum, against the state. So you already see here that there's a problem. It's a foreign investor that puts a claim against the state. But there's no other way there. The state will never be able to put a claim against an investor if it doesn't respect the treaty, right? So already we have a one-way justice system. It puts a claim when it doesn't like a law. This is why there's a nice picture of a parliament. A court justice or a contract, a new contract decision, yeah? So that's the three things that an investor can take a state in tribunal for. And this is based on international investment treaties, and it happens in private tribunals. So that's why I was saying it. You can sue a state in international forum. So far, we know that there's 667 cases that are known. You don't have to actually say anything when you put a claim. So there might be more cases that we don't know. This is UN figure. This comes from the United Nations Commission on Trade and Development, UNCTAD. So those are official UN figures. And, you know, the problem that we've seen so far with ISDS is foreign investors have been actually attacking laws that we really need. Laws against, you know, ban on chemicals, environmental regulations, patent laws, anti-smoking legislations. I mean, it's been used a lot against public interest legislation, which is why there's so much controversy around it now. Okay, so a bit of law. I understand no one here is a lawyer, right? Okay, good. Because me neither. But I can understand it. So the reason why you have those tribunals is because you have a treaty that gives rights to investors, right? And if the investor feels those rights are not respected, they can get it enforced with ISDS. Investment, so if you have a trade deal, sometimes it's 1,400 pages of very complicated words, and you have one chapter, investment, that has an enforcement mechanism, ISDS. But the labor chapter, the sustainable environment, or the sustainable development, or the environment chapter, they don't get enforced. But this one gets enforced. So here you have a sanction mechanism. If it's not respected, you have a forum where you can ask sanctions and compensation from the state. This is important as well because it shows, you know, what kind of priority the deals are putting on. So first, the first reasons why you had ISDS in the first place was because the first, you know, rationale was Germany was going to invest in Pakistan. It was worried about the court system. It was worrying about parliaments, about corruption, and about expropriation. He was worried about communism, basically, saying, I'm going to get there, invest a lot of money, and all of a sudden they might nationalize my property and I'll get away with nothing. That was the rationale when it started, yeah? So that's why you have protection against expropriation. And if you had only direct expropriation, you would find it, you know, normal, no? Nobody would like, I mean, if you buy a house, you don't want somebody to take it the next day, right? Normal. Indirect expropriation is a bit more difficult because indirect expropriation is actually the amount of profits that you expected, but that you didn't get. So here, you can ask for money that you were planning on getting, but that you didn't actually get. So this is for lost profits on money that you haven't invested yet. Can you imagine how this can be interpreted? So this is already a controversial claim. Sorry. It's not working anymore. The other three, well, you won't see, but I'll keep going. There's also fair and equitable treatment. So this is, you know, you could say this is normal. An investor, a foreign investor wants to have a fair and equitable treatment. You also have a clause that's called national treatment. So for instance, if Uruguay only has liquor strike cigarettes, and it actually puts a legislation on tobacco, Philip Morris can say, well, you know, this is discrimination against foreign investors, you know? You're not treating the national investors the same way as the foreign investors. So that's what we call national treatment. There's also the there's also the most favorite nation treatment. That's a bit complicated, but actually that's really important. In the treaty, there is a, so you can use the most favorite nation treatment to say, for instance, it's working again. Okay. For instance, there was a case against Russia based on a charter, the energy charter, that was signed in Russia when Russia was still the Soviet Union. And when people claimed against Russia, they said, well, actually, I think that Poland gets a better treatment with Russia than another country. So I'm going to use the Poland-Russia agreement because I have the most favored nation. So I'm using the agreement that favors the nation. It's a bit complicated, no? I'll do another example. In the TPP, the deal between the United States and the Pacific countries, you have a tobacco carve-out, so it shouldn't apply to tobacco. But if Philip Morris sues the United States, he can say to the United States, you have the TTIP with the European Union where there's no carve-out, so I can use the TTIP to sue you. So the investor has the right to choose a part of a bilateral investment treaty that he likes most. Does that make it a bit more easier to understand? Okay, when we give an example, it'll be better. And then the free transfer of funds guarantee basically is a state cannot put capital controls on foreign investors, so they can't have their capital stuck in one country. This is illegal. Another right that the deals give is the umbrella clause. So if tomorrow the city of, city of Le Caire, Cairo, actually, you know, changes its contract with Veolia on water, this contract between Veolia and Cairo can be sued and he'll be elevated as an international treaty. So that's what we call umbrella. It's like an umbrella, no? You do this. Well, the treaty that was between two small, you know, city and a company actually goes into international law. This is so controversial and has created so much problem that Canada actually refused it. And Canada was signing CETA under Harper. And you all know that Harper wasn't a radical lefty. Eh? Well, he refused it in CETA. And another one is limits on certain performance requirements. So if tomorrow Canada says, I only want my solar panels here to be 40% made in Canada, or if, I don't know, Poland says, my electricity to come, you know, 20% from renewables made in Poland. Again, this is illegal under investment treaties. So that's the rights that are given to investors. But the problem is ISDS. It's how they're actually interpreted. And I think this is where the private justice system is a problem, because you can have all those rights on paper, but then if you have private tribunals to interpret them, then you can have a conflict of interest. And you also have an interest to give, you know, those rights what we call an expansive interpretation. Because the more rights you give to investors, the more they're going to sue states, the more you're going to have business. Because here, when Canada gets sued, for instance, it has to go to a private law firm to buy an arbitrator. So the company gets an arbitrator, has to pay for it. Canada has an arbitrator, has to pay for it. And both parties pay for the judge, the third person. So you would have Canada, the company, and the third person that's going to decide. Each Canada and the company pay for their own arbitrator, and they pay half for the judge, which is actually not a judge. But anyway, give you cases that might be easier to understand. When Germany wanted to stop nuclear power, or it did ban stop nuclear power, Vattenfall, which had, you know, they knew they wanted to invest in nuclear energy, but all of a sudden Germany said, no, no more nuclear energy. They said, well, you know, all this profit that I was going to make, and then I'm going to lose. So they're suing Germany for 4.7 billion euros. It hasn't been settled yet. Philip Morris in Uruguay. Is anybody from Uruguay here? No? Uruguay wanted to have health warnings on cigarettes. Well, Philip Morris wasn't really happy about it. At the beginning, it asked for $2 billion. It makes such a public criticism and such a public debate that now they're asking for $25 million. They're using Switzerland-Uruguay bilateral investment agreements. So Philip Morris uses his company in Switzerland. In the Switzerland-Uruguay bilateral investment treaty, there's an exception for public health. But Philip Morris doesn't care. It used a thing on intellectual property rights. And it argues that actually having a health warning reduces his trademark, his Philip Morris trademark. Here, long pipe. Anybody heard about this one? Anybody from Canada? No? Canada has a trade deal with the United States and Mexico called NAFTA, North American Free Trade Agreement. Lone Pipe is a fracking company. No, you all know what fracking is? Yeah, it's when you... you all know, right. And Quebec had a referendum on fracking. The people of Quebec voted against fracking in a majority vote. So what happened is Quebec actually put a moratorium. Lone Pipe is a Canadian company, and they had planned on investing in fracking in Quebec. So they used a US subsidiary in Delaware to sue Canada against the moratorium on fracking. And it's asking from Canada. I don't know what's happening. $109 million. Okay, all right, it'll come back. Okay. Which is quite scandalous because it's a Canadian company suing its own government and but using what we call letterbox company, no? So that's a problem. Lilly, I don't know how you say it, it's an American drug company. It was selling a drug in Canada, and the Canadian government actually started, having second thoughts about it. And then there was a court judgment that there was actually no real proof of the clinical results of this product. So Lilly put Canada into court and is asking for $500 million. So I don't know, Lilly, again using NAFTA. The drugs that they were going to sell, that the Canadian courts actually asked to get withdrawn from the market, were later withdrawn in the United States. But it's because they didn't want it to be withdrawn in the United States that they sued Canada. Then that was sending a message to the United States saying, you see, if you ban it in the United States, we'll sue you as well. And then unfortunately, there's loads of other cases. And some in the European Union as well. So you have ACMEA, the Dutch insurance company, that sued the Slovak Republic in 2008. Basically, in 2000, there was a liberalization of the health insurance in Slovakia, and it wasn't working at all. There was general elections. Slovakians voted for a party that actually said, as one of the campaign priority, that they will reverse the privatization because it was not working. So in 2004, when they came to government, they reversed it. ACMEA, who was actually having some shares in one of the largest health company, actually put a claim against the Slovak Republic and got awarded €22.1 million for damages. That's much more than the amount that they actually invested in the beginning. And in this case, I find it very, very funny. Because this one shows you how crazy the system is. You had a coal power station next to Hamburg. And then there was a new environmental law. Again, the coal power station was operated by Vattenfall. It's a Swedish company, but it's one of the third biggest energy company in Germany. So Germany wanted to limit the pollution of water, so to raise environmental standards. So in application of this new law, the city of Hamburg actually asked the coal power station to be, to be more careful about its emission in water, not on water pollution. Vattenfall wasn't happy about having to invest in cleaning, the water that it rejected. So it sued Germany. Because the treaty, that's the umbrella clause, no? You have a contract between Hamburg and Vattenfall. Vattenfall is not happy. It becomes part of the international treaty and it sues Germany. When Hamburg saw the amount of money that Vattenfall wanted and the amount of money that they had to spend just, to protect themselves from a law court, they actually said, well, you know what? Forget about it. I'm just going to forget about the new law. We'll just go back to the one before and we'll just all settle it down. Great. Settled. Germany lowers the water standards. We don't hear about it anymore. The problem is Germany doesn't respect anymore the Habitat Directive of the European Union. So it's one of the directives on the protection of water. So the Commission now is suing Germany for not respecting an environmental legislation. It's crazy, no? Okay, it's crazy. Why? How did we get there? Because you're going to think, wow, this is like crazy. So as I was saying, it was mainly started in the 50s, 60s, mainly for northern investors to protect the investment in the south. The first BIT, bilateral investment treatment, was Germany and Pakistan in 59. The one with ISDS was in 69 was Netherlands and Indonesia. Anybody from the Netherlands here? No? It's actually the country that has the most BITs, bilateral investment treaties, because it's the country where it's the easiest to open a letterbox company. So there's a lot of companies that actually will open a subsidiary in the Netherlands to be able to sue their own government. This happened to Spain. When Spain reduced the subsidies to the renewable sector, renewable energy companies opened letterbox companies in the Netherlands and sued Spain. And then in the 90s, you started having a lot of BITs being signed, like the Energy Charter Treaty, which actually spans across a lot of countries and it's only about energy, and NAFTA, the North African Trade Agreement. It was signed, I don't remember when, but it was implemented in 94, the 1st of January 94. That's when it started putting in place. It's Mexico, United States, and Canada. And it has ISDS. The cases that I was talking about before, a lot of them come from NAFTA and some from the Energy Charter. Italy is being sued under the Energy Charter. And they just realized how costly it's going to be, so they pulled out of the Energy Charter. And the first one with ISDS, actually the symbol is quite powerful, Netherlands, Indonesia. The Indonesian government is trying to pull out of it as well. South Africa has pulled out of all its bilateral investment treaties with ISDS because it was sued by Italy, actually, by Italian investors. So it's not something that's popular in the South because actually southern countries have understood that it was going to be used against public interest legislation or even against any legislation that would harm profits, and also it costs a lot of money to states. So because it's a private system, you have an incentive for the law firms to attract clients, no? They get clients, they get a case, the client wins and he comes back and you get more money, and that's why it creates what you have here. That's one of the problems with those systems. In the national system, a judge has a salary. Whatever he decides, he has a salary. In this system, the judge is paid by a law firm that itself represents an investor or a state. So here he has it's not a long-term job. He needs to find new clients. No? So that's a huge difference. And this is why you have all those cases that have been raising over the years, where it's like, you know, a vicious circles of cases bringing more and more cases. Again, it's UNCTAD, and this is for 2014. Okay. Have you heard about all those acronyms before? I just want to show you one thing because I think it's quite important. ICSID, International Court for Settlement of Investment Disputes, is actually based in the World Bank. And this is where, you know, 62% of the cases happen. In ICSID, it's actually the president, most of the time it's the president of the World Bank that decides on the judge. We're going to call them judge, but they're not really judge. But so you have two arbitrators, company, state, and the judge that decides, right? In the World Bank, ICSID is actually the president of the World Bank. And the president of the World Bank always comes from United States of America. And the only country that's never lost a case in ICSID is? Exactly, you get it. So there's a real, you know, it was created really at the beginning as a northern project to actually, you know, be able to invest in the South without having any problem, and if there was any problem, get a lot of money back. And there's still this bit, you know, this neo-colonial thinking into this treaty. So it's important that you see that the World Bank has a huge influence into those treaties. And one of the problems with the World Bank tribunals is that they don't actually have to be known. So we don't know the cases. We don't always know the judges. We don't know the settlements. Well, there's a lot of things that we don't know, unfortunately. That's the cases against the US and the EU. You see the ones of the EU raising, the US doesn't raise that much. There's not much point in suing the United States because they win a lot. So you don't win that much if you sue the US. You understand now why, what I was saying about the World Bank. But you get, you know, you can win a lot if you sue the EU. So that's why there's a lobbying towards keeping ISDS and TTIP and CETA, because this is a huge market for law firms and for investors. I'm going to talk a lot about investors and law firms. And there's maybe some, like a third party that I should not forget, so I'm going to tell you now, is you actually have pension funds, hedge funds, financial organizations, private organizations, that actually can fund your case. So you have organizations that actually can go to investors and say, you can sue this country, I know you don't have money now, but I'll pay for your case, and once you get compensation, you'll give me a percentage of what you get. And this clearly, again, explains why this market is skyrocketing. It's because you have people that are, they have third people, third organizations that are also making money out of the system. So it's not always the investors and the law firms that create an incentive. It's also the third party funding. Okay. You'll hear the European Commission that tells you that we need ISDS in TTIP and CETA. And no, it's not for multinationals only. Small and medium enterprise are going to be able to use it if they feel discriminated in the United States. Well, this is from an academic study from Gus van Harten, who's a teacher in Toronto Law School. And when he found out, it looks, I don't remember, I think it's more than 200 cases that he looked at. And 94.5% of them, the money that from those awards, went to company over $1 billion. So we're not talking about small and medium enterprise here. And individuals over $100 million in net wealth. You have to think about, just pause here for a moment. I can say most of the cases, right? 94.5%. Most of the cases when the investor wins, the investors actually are either very rich individuals or very rich companies. And what they receive in this compensation, it's taxpayers' money. This is our money. This is, you know, the government budget. This is money that doesn't go to health and education because it goes to very rich individuals or very wealthy companies. So there's clearly here a strong injustice. At least I think. Okay, and the problems. The first one, and I was saying, this is all money coming from public budgets, taxpayers, it's us. There's a risk against regulations, especially environment regulation and social regulations, and democracy in general. And then there's just the common problems of rule of law. Okay, I'll start with the boring legal stuff. The problem of the substantive rights. So all those rights that get enforced with ISDS, right? First, as I was saying, there's rights for investors, but there's no obligations. I mean, they get all those rights to do all those things in the state, in the nation, but there's no obligation. There's no obligation to pay taxes, no? Or no obligation to respect local laws. Or, you know, there's no obligation at all. It's only rights for investors. That's the only thing there is. And it's, in a way, especially if you think about the treaties that are going to happen with the European Union, it's going to give Canadian and American investors more rights than Polish investors in France, for instance, or Italian investors in Spain. The Americans and Canadian investors will have more rights because they will have all those treaties when Spanish and Italian investors will be under European law, you know, that doesn't grant all those rights. Obviously, there's a big problem about secrecy. As I was telling, we don't always know the case. When we know the case, we don't always know how it settles. We don't always know who deals with it, how, where. I mean, there's lots of things that we don't know. Affected third parties are not. if you had a case like fracking, for instance, there was a ban on fracking, the communities that are hurt by fracking are actually not represented there. There's no appeal. So once there's a case, that's it, thank you, bye. No appeal possible for the state, and obviously no independence. You can clearly, there's a clearly conflict of interest there. Okay, as I was saying, in ICSID, the World Bank, it's the appointment of the arbitrator, so the person that's going to decide in favor of state or investor, is actually appointed by ICSID, so by the World Bank. The arbitrator is appointed by the parties, by the state and the investor in the other courts. They earn $3,000 a day. That's probably what I earn in a month. Sometimes for law firms it's $1,000 an hour. We're talking about a lot of legal fees here. And obviously, as I was saying, there's an incentive to decide in favor of the claimant, of the investor, because they're the one that's going to issue the next case, they're going to give you $3,000 a day. So there's a clear conflict of interest. This is the Attorney General of Singapore. I'll let you read it. It's similar to what I was saying. I just wanted to show that it's not just us, the NGOs, that are against it, that there's actually a critical voice in the legal field as well. This is actually an arbitrator himself that actually wonders how states actually sign on to this. Because there's obviously, you know, there's the case, the fact that it's going to cost you a lot of money and probably going to make you change laws. But there's also the fact that it's here. There's a threat. That's like a deterrent. A company can tell government, you want to raise taxes on oil extraction, right? Great, do it. We'll see you in court. Obviously, the company in the state is going to think twice about it. Especially if you are, you know, Uruguay, Ecuador, Zimbabwe, I don't know. And Chevron comes and say, really? You want to put a tax on oil extraction? Okay, I'll see you in court. And then, you know, Zimbabwe has to spend its whole half budget on a claim for Chevron. So there's obviously a deterrent there. It has actually changed laws. Like the case I was telling you about Hamburg, you know, we call it Vattenfall 1 because there was a second Vattenfall, the nuclear power. Here you clearly had, you mean the change law here. It's clear that you had a direct effect on legislation. It's quite old case now, but the MMT was actually banned in Canada because it's a neurotoxin. Canada was sued by an American investor, and Canada ended up repealing the ban and actually saying, no, actually, it's fine. There's no problem with MMT. So here again, you see that there's a clear change in legislation because of ISDS, a clear threat to democracy. New Zealand, that comes from the health minister. Australia was sued by Philip Morris using the Hong Kong-Australia bilateral investment treaty because Australia wanted to have plain packaging on cigarettes packets. It was sued. The case has been lost like 2 weeks or 3 weeks ago by Philip Morris. During the entire time of the case, between 3 to 4 years, the New Zealand health minister kept saying, I'm not doing anything on tobacco before we see what happens to Australia. Australia ended up spending millions of dollars defending itself for a case that at the end that was settled because it was actually, there was a problems with proceedings. So actually Philip Morris didn't win, Australia didn't lose because the judge found there was a proceeding problem, but still both parties had to pay for their legal costs, which means Australia at the end still had to pay a lot of money, but to law firms, not to Philip Morris. Here you have a Canadian government official that explains actually this, how really when you have a new environmental or social regulation, you can have law firms coming on behalf of investors and say, you sure you want to do this? That's going to cost you a lot of money. And this is a meeting that happened actually between, so the commission works in DG, Directorate Generals. DG Trade, the people in the Commission that negotiate TTIP and CETA. DG Energy are the people that negotiate on energy for the Commission. They had a meeting with Chevron. One of the things we do a lot in CEO is we ask freedom of information requests. So we ask documents from the Commission when they meet external people. Who have they met? What did they talk about? Etc., etc. We saw that they met with Chevron. We asked for a summary of the meeting, and we got this quote from the summary of the meeting. Chevron argues that the mere existence of ISDS is important as it acts as a deterrent. Chevron only used once ISDS against Ecuador. But still, what he says, it's not about the amount of time you use it, it's about the fact that it's here, you know? The fact that you can use it against any new legislation that you don't like. And this is really important because a lot of the times when we talk about TTIP and CETA, people think we're going to lose the laws that we have now, which is true. But it's also about the laws that we need and we won't get, and we won't even talk about it, because a law firm will have come to a legislator before there's actually a public debate. So, and it's not just, you know, it's not only the European Union that's going to be sued, you know, the United States and Canada, they also have a chance of being sued. Lower, but still there's a chance. This again to show the kind of the ideology behind. You have to think that some of the negotiators for those investment treaties, they kind of don't really trust the state. That's why they don't want a public system. They think legislation is something not that great. There's a very, you know, liberal ideology behind about we need protection from the state, because the state could actually be, you know, listening to people and doing things that goes against companies' profits. Something here that's important also in the second quote, it's that you have at the moment about 25% for the state, 30% for the investors, and 30% cases that are settled. And actually when they are settled, most of the time is because the state changes a law or agrees to change something without paying compensation. It's when the legal cost becomes so high that they say, all right, we'll do something about it now, like happened in Hamburg. So just, you know, it's a threat. If the law still goes through and the companies don't like it, they can actually start the claim, and then they can go to the government and say, if you want to stop now, we can find a way to settle this down. And settlements are not public. So we don't actually know what's been decided in these settlements. Okay, that's quite depressing, sorry. You're all gonna end up thinking that the world is shit, but sorry. King & Spalding is a very big law firm, an arbitration law firm, one of the biggest. They sent this to their clients in 2011. Don't know if you remember, but in 2011, when they were starting a lot of trouble in Libya, and they sent this as an alert to their clients, the oil and gas companies, and they say, look guys, Libya's not really protecting your investment really well. This is what we could do to sue them. It's an entire newsletter. I've just put you there, but you know what legal options are available in oil and gas companies. So those kind of law firms have no ethics. They sued Argentina when Argentina was in financial crisis. Argentina couldn't pay, so they grounded the Boeing from Aerolíneas Argentinas in Houston. They were actually gonna, you know, sell it and get money for the investors from it. They sued Greece, financial crisis. They sued Spain. They sued Cyprus. I mean, they don't, you know, business is business. Okay, kind of the costs. It's quite expensive. The case of Chevron and Ecuador is really. Chevron had a leak in the Amazon forest. The Ecuadorian government asked Chevron to pay for it and to clean up, basically clean up your mess, right? It's Chevron, they should have the means to do it. This was appealed and appealed by Chevron, and ended up in the Ecuadorian Supreme Court that actually said, yeah, Chevron, please pay for your mess. Chevron still didn't want to pay, so it went in international arbitration, it won. It's asking now $1 billion from Ecuador. It was asking $2 billion before, but it's got so controversial that now it only asked for $1 billion. Okay, nice. So it's now only 1% of GDP. Poland had a national health system in the communist time. Then it opened. It opened it to private, to what we call it liberalization. But 30% of a share of the health insurance market was actually bought by a Dutch company. There was a government that promised that the Dutch company would get 51%. Then the government changed and said, actually, privatization is not a good idea. So you'll keep your 30%, but you'll never get your 51%. It was sued. Poland lost. Poland had to pay $2 billion. And this is a settlement that was made public. So the company actually wanted much more than that. Yeah, it's Eureko. And the health insurance company, the name is this, PSN, PZN? No? Okay, I thought you were Polish, so maybe you... Yeah? You know? No, I think it's... No, it is Poland. Let me check this one. PZU, Ubensizen SA? Oh, my Polish is, inexistent. But yeah, it is Poland. There was a case against the Czech Republic as well for the health system, for the TV, but not the health system. There was a case against health insurance in Slovakia as well. That was ACMEA. Par contre, j'ai pas du tout pour le. Je parle trop ou pas assez?
Non, c'est très bien.
J'ai pas regardé le temps. Je sais pas, tout à l'heure il s'est arrêté aussi. And there's another case that's 935 million for Libya. So it's one of those cases during the Libyan crisis. And this one, I find it very outrageous. So the company was rewarded $935 million because it had invested $35 million, but it was expecting $900 million in profits. So Libya had to reimburse $935 million. Not only the $35 million that were invested, but the $900 million that were gonna get profits out of it. And that's the crazy thing about it. You would argue that the direct expropriation of the investment, the $35 million, should be reimbursed. I mean, depending on the conditions, depending on a lot of things. But the fact that what you expect as a profit has to be reimbursed is pretty crazy, especially if you look at the amount, and especially if you think about the situation of Libya. Against Libya? I don't know, but I can look after because I forgot it. I'll have a look. So in terms of cost, it's $8 million per case, which is crazy. The Philippines government wanted to open a third terminal in Manila. It had a public tendering, it had offered it to Fraport, and then it realized it didn't have enough money, and then Fraport wasn't actually corresponding to local rules. So there was a public tender open to Fraport, and then when contract were being made, actually, they realized that Fraport was not paying enough attention to local laws. They had to spend $58 million just to defend themselves. In the defense against Vattenfall, it's costing €9 million to Germany. This is a public figure that comes from the Bundestag. It's from the economics committee of the Bundestag. So again, this is a lot of money for Germany. And this person that I was telling you about, the legal professor, Gus van Harten, he's been looking at 214 cases. It's the figures that I told you before about the 94.5% of the awards. And this is the amount that states have paid to the ISDS industry. So the lawyers, the arbitrators, the experts, the arbitral institution, because you have to pay the World Bank for giving them the beautiful offices in New York. $856 million in total to the ISDS industry. So it's big money, big business. Okay, that's kind of the reasons in figures why it would be such a threat for the European Union if you had ISDS and TTIP and CETA. First, because 40% of the FDI that we have in the European Union comes from the United States. So that's a lot of FDI covered. When the wall fell after the Cold War, a lot of countries in Eastern Europe signed bilateral investment treaties with the United States. In Eastern Europe. In Western Europe, we don't have that much investment treaties with the United States. So at the moment, there's 19 countries that don't have bilateral investments with the United States. They're going to have one. That means that 99% of US foreign direct investment in the EU is going to be covered. There's also a problem with the definition of investor. A shareholder in a company that has 0.1% of a company is an investor, and he can sue a state. So it's not a limited definition of investor. It's quite an expensive definition of investor. So as a shareholder, you don't have to hold the entire company to actually sue the state. It would empower 47,000 US companies based in the EU. It's a lot. Only 8% of US firms are protected by ISDS at the moment. And they've already claimed more than 30 billion euros in compensation. So that's what they received from the state. That's the they claimed and they received as well. And obviously, you know, we never talk enough about it. We always focus on TTIP. In France, we call it TAFTA, but all around Europe, we call it TTIP, except in France. And we shouldn't forget about CETA, because, you know, as you saw, a US company could actually open an office in Canada and use CETA to sue. Okay. So as you imagine, ISDS is something that only some geeks in some organizations used to look at before because it's quite technical and boring and transparent. And then all of a sudden when Europe starts signing those deals, people were like, wow, what's going on? And the more people learn about it, the more there's public opposition to it. Not just from the NGOs, from elected politicians, from some companies, small and medium enterprise, for instance. There's kind of a public debate that's grown big, especially in Germany, because the good thing about Germany is that it got sued twice, so there's cases that it can talk to German people. So the debate started, you know, getting on the public sphere. Why do we need ISDS? Why it's a threat? And there's obviously lots of public opposition. And the opposition has gone so strong that the people in the commission actually couldn't, you know, they couldn't avoid it. They had to start listening, right? So in order to listen, they had a public consultation. So what usually happens in your opinion when you have a public consultation is you have a website online with questions in English only that you can answer, giving your opinion about a certain thing. So what happened is the ISDS chapter, an investment chapter of CETA, was put online for the consultation and then there were questions about it. The questions were not whether ISDS was a good thing or not. The questions were what kind of ISDS would be good. And even though the questions were about this, 97% of people added in the comment below or at some point in the consultation, they didn't want it. And the 97% of people that were against it, it's not only, you know, campaign groups or citizens, there were academics, trade unions, there was the French National Telecom Operation Organization, there was the Länder of Bavaria, that's actually, you know, run by CDU, conservative government. There were companies as well, there's the Austrian Public Water System Organizations. So you had lots of people that actually raised concerns and even opposition to ISDS. Just to give you a little aparte, because there was 97% of people that were against ISDS, the law firms in Brussels, the one that are actually going to win from ISDS, they started creating a lobby group. It's called EFILA, and it's in London. And now every time there's a public debate in Brussels on ISDS, they're always there. But it gives you a little bit, you know, the idea of democracy, you know? Oh, people are not happy about it? Well, it's fine. We'll create a lobby group, and we'll still get our way through. it was non-binding, but the European Parliament was asked its opinion on ISDS in July last year. And that's part of the resolution where they demand to replace ISDS. And they put a lot of conditions to it. And this is part of it, mostly to be more transparent, to be professional judges, to have an appeal mechanism. Or they say appeal, I'll say appeal. And so the commission had to do something about it, no? 97% of people are against it, and not just, you know, like some economic operators as well. Parliament is asking for a change. It's a right majority government, you know? I mean, parliament is as a majority of European People's Party, which means they're right, so it's not, I mean. But the vote is very funny because you have Eastern Europeans and Western Europeans that voted differently, and left and right as well. It was actually quite a divided vote. You can tell how it has become very divided and political. But what we got is, well, we call it lipstick on a pig in English. That's why you have this picture. Or ISDS light. It's basically a new name now. It's the investment court system. But there's no change in CETA. So CETA hasn't changed now. It's still, you know, being legally scrubbed. There's no question. There's no discussion or question about changing the investment chapter. In TTIP, it's changed, and now it's the investment court system. And I'm going to show you how it's not actually that different. So that's problems, the legal problems. That's whether they addressed in CETA, and that's whether they addressed in the new proposal. Basically, now, the secrecy of proceedings is not here anymore. I mean, in the new proposal and in CETA, you have to show the case. People have to know the case. Now, in the new ISDS, in TTIP, you have an appeal mechanism. Sorry. Third parties, more or less, can be heard now in the new proposal of TTIP. This one, so now you have the right to regulate is protected. Now it's in the text of the new ISDS in TTIP. But this, it says, the state has the right to regulate if needed. I have to find the text again. So there's what we call a needs test. So it has the right to regulate, but it needs to prove that it needed to regulate. And this has been interpreted in a very open way. So the right to regulate is in the Argentina, United States bilateral investment treatment. When Argentina was sued during the financial crisis, he argued that I needed to regulate. I was in a difficult situation. The judge said, no, sorry, not really. The judge was actually the Chilean ambassador to the United Kingdom during the Pinochet years. Give you a bit of an idea the kind of people that are going to interpret the rights. Because it's not just about the paper again, it's about how you interpret it. So the rights to regulate is there, but it's submitted to what we call the needs test, and it's been, you know, interpreted in a very loose way. And then now the tribunals, so now there'll be a roster of people. You'll be paid to be available as a judge. You can have other jobs, but you'll be paid to be a judge for those tribunals in TTIP. It gives a little bit of independence, but still they can have a side job. So that's partial independence. They'll still be paid by case, but they'll have some money to be available when needed, and it'll be only, you know, a roster of judges that the EU and the US chooses. And then that's the other things that are not, I haven't changed, unfortunately. You'll still have greater rights for foreign investors. You can have claims against public interest legislation. You know, the arbitrators will tend to favor investors. It's a risk for budget, and there's a risk for regulatory chill. So you basically have still the same private system, despite the fact that you have some changes. And this is Freshfields, Clifford Change, White & Case, Sidley Austin. They're the kind of law firms that get money a lot from ISDS. And basically, he admitted to the Australian Daily their standard that doesn't change anything. The standards on the basis of which judgments are rendered remain the same. So the way judgments are made remain the same. So maybe the text that the judge has to interpret is a bit different, but the way and the incentives and all those things remain the same. So this is basically kind of it gives you the main arguments that of all the thing. Like, despite the fact that we might have a new proposal now, we still have the same problems. And because we're not always against everything, and sometimes we have proposals, there is a proposal for an alternative in the United Nations. United Nations, Ecuador in South of Africa, have presented to the UN Human Rights Council a demand for a treaty on rights and responsibilities of multinationals, which actually give them responsibilities, and which will also enable citizens to actually sue multinationals in case they think they haven't respected their rights and responsibilities. So that would be made at the United Nations level, so it would be public tribunals, you know, paid judge, UN procedures. It was a proposal that was put on the table by South Africa and Ecuador, and the United States and European Union refused it. And not only did they refuse it, they were actually calling embassies in the South, telling countries, if you actually support this, we'll stop giving you development money. So they were clearly lobbying against it. Because of the balance of power and the way the UN works, it actually went through, and now they're actually creating a working group to see how this could be happening. So here we're trying to talk about a deal that has both rights and responsibilities for multinationals, something that's based on public law, the United Nations. And here we find the EU member states and the United States actually pushing against it. So there's a clear, you know, you can see how, or there's actually, you know, the way that they think about trade, you know. It's all about trade and investors and multinational and profits, but when it comes to, you know, social and environmental standards, it's clearly something that comes second, you know. But still, it's going through. It might take, you know, 10 to 15 years before we maybe get something. At least it's an alternative. Am I good on time? Yeah? Okay, cool. That's my email if you need anything. Thank you. You're younger than me, so use them more than me. This is Twitter. We have a Twitter account. We tweet mostly in English. And we have a Facebook as well if you want to follow us. That's where we put everything. We have a website, but it's not actually as nice as a Facebook and our Twitter, so I'll do some ads for this. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
We are Floriana and Laura, and we wanted to thank you very much for, it's very nice to meet you, and thank you for your presentation. For me to analyze this very, very interesting topic, which actually affects our everyday lives, even if we don't realize it. So this is the scheme. I'm first going to be talking a little bit about the introduction, what an international investment dispute mechanism is, and also maybe sketch why this system could be a threat to democracy and analyze its unilateral character. And then Laura is going to talk about the investment state dispute settlement in the TTIP. And also she's going to talk about the relationship between transnational cooperation and human rights. And we're going to hopefully make a little commentary and have some questions to ask you. So what, first of all, these international investment disputes are. You've already recalled some of the cases. This is the ones that I think are more, I found more interesting and very scary for some parts. So basically, private multinational companies can actually have the possibilities to sue governments based on the fact that they can ask for compensation for lost profits. The crazy thing I found is that not only they can ask compensation for lost profits that, for instance, laws and regulations of a sovereign state makes, but they also can claim for compensation for envisioned future profits, which is a bit insane. So you've already mentioned these cases, but I found really interesting these three especially. The first one is the tobacco giant Philip Morris against versus Uruguay and Australia. As you've already said, there was this compulsory labeling, this health warnings on cigarettes packages, and the company thought that this labeling was too big, and it actually could conceal their trademark, their logo. So actually, this is a case of corporation versus public health. You've already talked about Vattenfall versus Germany, the first and second lawsuits. So basically, I'm not going to talk again about it, but I think it's, of course, this is another case where Germany wanted to introduce some restrictions, environmental restrictions, especially for, I think, the discharge and use of water, of cooling water from one of the plants, like coal-fired plants. And Germany actually, the company Vattenfall actually managed there was a settlement where they managed to lower the environmental standards. And this has caused and keeps causing on the Elde River in Hamburg. It has a very huge impact on the wildlife of the river, and it's actually maybe the cause of algae, which actually are polluting the Elbe River in Hamburg. What is very peculiar, I found, is that in the second lawsuit, they actually did this lawsuit after Germany's decision to phase out nuclear energy in the aftermath of the Fukushima events. But they actually claimed for, I think, 3.5 billion euros compensation for two nuclear plants that were already not working prior to the decision. So it's kind of insane, I think. Also, you've already mentioned that also corporations target countries that are in debt or might have might have to go under debt restructuring, and they have to implement reforms to restructure their system. Actually, 40 companies sued Argentina after its crisis in 2001. They were mainly energy companies because Argentina froze their utility rates. So Veolia, Aqua Barcelona, all these energy companies sued Argentina, and they're also suing her for legislation to restructure the economy. So what is the legal basis the multinational corporation can sue states? They're actually international investments agreements, and there are over 3,000 nowadays. They actually enforce this investor states dispute settlement provisions. They are contained in the bilateral investment treaties. There are treaties made between two states, and they can also be found, these provisions, in free trade agreements, as the North American Free Trade Agreement, and also in multilateral agreement, as the Energy Charter, which regulates investments in energy issues. So what's crucial is that companies can and are able to bypass local courts, and they can sue governments before an international tribunal of arbitrators. The paper that you made us read argues the fairness and independence of the system. First of all, there are three arbitrators are appointed, one from the state and one from the company, while the third part is chosen jointly and acts as a chair. So they, of course, determine the award and its amount, and they also this system, a lot of criticism towards the system are actually aimed at the fact that there is no appeal, like you said, and the decision can be enforced anywhere in the world. Like a company could actually anywhere in the world take up some state's property anywhere. What are the system? So the first, the majority of cases is handled by the International Center for the Settlement of Investment Disputes, which, as you said, is in Washington in the World Bank. It was created in 1966. And actually, 30 years after ICSID was created in 1996, a study showed that there were only 33 investment states disputes that were handled in ICSID, and they were scared that might be soon be empty-handed because not all of cases were discussed. Actually, another data from 2011 shows that these cases have skyrocketed, and today we can count 450 cases only in ICSID. Other rules used are the rules of the United Nations Commission on International Trade Law, which are very used, or and there are other courts that companies can appeal to and can go to, which are permanent court of arbitration in The Hague, the London Court of International Arbitration, and the International Chamber of Commerce, which is actually here in Paris. First of all, this system was put in place because local courts were considered too biased, too slow or corrupted to deliver a judgment, and this was a concern for Western governments. We can say that this concern cannot be upheld anymore. So the idea was to have a neutral body of arbitrators. But we can argue, and as the paper also argues, the fairness and independence of this system is actually an illusion. The system is biased towards investors. Over the last 20 years, the majority of lawsuits actually have seen arbitrators grant companies multi-millionaire compensations, and these compensations are actually paid out of taxpayers' money. That, for instance, can be used to pay like the salary of thousands of teachers and thousands of doctors, instead are awarded to these multinational companies. Actually, 80% of these goes to the legal firms that represent them. So this situation is actually changing. A lot of states are actually dropping out of bilateral investment treaties, and they are also not including anymore these ISDS provisions in their trade agreements. The first case was Australia, which decided to not include this provision anymore. And also, most crucially, Bolivia, Ecuador, Venezuela actually dropped out of the International Settlement for Center for Settlement of Investment Disputes, and South Africa and India are on the same path. So this actually raises a lot of concerns for the system. We say this industry formed by law firms, arbitrators and their financiers. So they're actually trying to lobby to actually implement some reform of the system, but to actually maintain this reform are only superficial, and they are lobbying to maintain the system as it is. So of course, you've already talked about some of these things, but just to recall some points that really highlight the anti-democratic character of the system and of investor states dispute settlement provisions. So first of all, state sovereignty is in danger. They actually cannot freely implement laws and regulations that are aimed to implement environmental measures to promote public health and social security, and because these are challenged by multinational companies, and actually for them they represent some very, very lucrative business opportunities. So we can argue that governments cannot act in the interest of their people any longer. Also, what's really scary, I think, is that as you mentioned, this investor arbitration can also be used as a threat to freeze government action. So I think this is really scary because it actually stops the whole democratic and political process altogether from its start. We don't have in these treaties, in these provisions, like a true unilateral, a true like precise definition of what an investment is. And this is very beneficial for multinational companies and arbitrators, because the definition is so fluid and very blurred that they can actually decide what an investment is, and also they can virtually define investment anything that the multinational corporation are wanting to put forward. we can say there's every case, there are ad hoc case procedures, which means there's a lack of general recognized rules and procedures. I think the global arbitration review mentioned a little story where a professor showed the like the thickness of a UK box on raw courts and procedures, and how thin a booklet from the, I think, from the International Chamber of Commerce is. So you can see that there are no written rules. They're actually made ad hoc, and they're actually shared inside this inner circle of lawyers and arbitrators. So this is arguably a really unfair system. Also, who wins is you win only if you can afford the expertise. And with, as you said, lawyers earning up to 1,000 euros per hour or dollars per hour in the Case in White and all the other most relevant firms in international arbitration, of course, states cannot afford maybe all of this expertise, and they are doomed to lose all these causes. Also, we can say there are a huge conflict of interest. So, for instance, 1 minute, we can say 1 minute a person is, acts as a lawyer, as a counsel, and then towards maybe towards the end of their career, they become arbitrators. And as arbitrators, they can actually use this vague definition of investment to benefit multinational corporations. And they also can eventually even step in as in government, as representatives of government, and actually implement these agreements, lobby for this ESDS provisions to be inserted in the agreements. So there is this, this is actually defined as a close-knit community. It's a self-reinforcing community, and it's a base for existence is actually that it remains like this. So there's not a lot of room to change inside. So I'm going to introduce the TTIP, the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership. Just a few points, and then Lara is going to talk about the investor states dispute settlement provisions inside this this treaty. So first of all, we all know it is a bi-regional trade agreement that is currently carried out in secret between the European Union and the USA. The goal is to create a big market area accessible, but what is most critical is that it wants to reduce the regulatory barriers to trade. So this entails all the regulations and standards that are obviously so huge and different between Europe and the United States. So actually, it is there is a lobby which actually pushes for the TTIP to be put in place and implemented, and it is called the Transnational Business Council and represents over 70 multinational corporations. We have very little information of TTPI. Of course, it's carried out in secret. Only a few NGOs can get some information, but it's very rare. The negotiators are actually Dan Mulaney for the USA and Ignacio Maria Bercero for the European Union. So, the European Union sponsors this TTIP, saying that it'll boost the European economy, that it's actually the solution to get out of the crisis. For instance, there could be the 0.5% GDP increase for Europe and 0.4% for United States. But another independent study from the Austria Foundation for Development Research actually shows that these results will be actually seen in up to 20 years. So maybe this is not really the solution to get out of the crisis. This is just used as an excuse and as a justification to actually pass this act that is going to favor multinational corporations. It is very, very, we don't need to talk about this, but what's really critical is the fact that the need to homogenize standards and regulatory rules for the two continents, they're completely different. There are a lot of concerns about food security. For instance, like GMOs could come into Europe even if they are forbidden. Beef that with growth hormones inside can be sold and eaten here. There are also like very different procedures when it comes to toxic substances, because in the United States, everything can be put on trade until it is proven that it is toxic. In Europe, it's the total opposite. It first has to pass through an authorization to verify that it is safe. So it's a huge issue. So I'm talk too much. I'm gonna let Laura talk a bit about ISDS in the TTIP.
Well, I'm going to talk about the current situation of the investor-state dispute settlement in the TTIP. But I think you already said almost everything. But just to remind, the European Commission make a proposal of create an investment core system instead of this investor-state dispute settlement. But actually, it is only just a change in the name, because the same objectives are the same possible result of the arbitration system will be the same, and it's the same way to understand the justice as a private and privileged justice for foreign investor, and completely away from the national legal system. And as you already said, there's no modification in the arbitration system from the CETA, the agreement with Canada. And there was in this last month, there was a first reaction from the US side that they reject to these changes. So now the situation is in a kind of limbo. We don't know what is going to happen. And now I'm going to change completely the topic, because for me, talking about this investment state dispute settlement without talking about the transnational corporation power hasn't have any sense. So I'm gonna talk a little bit, and I'm gonna put in context this ISDS. First of all, we can divide the transnational corporation power in three type of power: the economic power, that we already know, that does have this oligopoly and this market concentration that this transnational corporation create. The problem of the fiscal evasion, which is really related with the tax haven as well. The money laundry, well, many problems that all of us already know. But there's another size of this power, which is the political power. The political power has a lot to do with this lobbying that this transnational corporation are doing to the state to promote the regulation and privatization policies, but also with this landing track. I don't know if I translate it right, because I only heard about this work in Spanish, but this landing track is when a government generate a good situation for promoting the foreign direct investment in their country. They change the law just to attract investment, foreign investment. And then we can talk about this trading promotion. All of us, I think we are aware that when there's an institutional visit to another country, our ambassador or our minister, they go with a group of CEOs from the multinational companies to promote investment abroad. And so actually the link between the political sphere and the transnational corporation is huge. And the foreign policies as well, that is in many senses related with this that I already said. But I want to focus in the juridical power, because we can understand this investor-state dispute settlement inside this juridical power that transnational companies have. And to understand that, we need to talk about the lex mercatoria. What is the lex mercatoria? The lex mercatoria is the body of commercial law used by merchants throughout of Europe during the medieval period. And a distinct feature of this law, it was the reliance by merchant on a legal system developed and administered by them. So it was completely away from the national legislation. This lex mercatoria is on the stage again, because all of this power that the transnational corporate have, they are in juridical terms reading in this new Lex Mercatoria. So actually this International Arbitration Tribunal or International Investment Treaty has only one part of this power. It's a system that is based on the same principle than this old Lex Mercatoria, which was used in the medieval period, based on efficiency, party autonomy, and choice of arbitrator. And it's based on a mutual agreement between the party implicated. So it's based on the idea of self-regulation. So I really believe that we are now like really, really worried about the TTIP and the effects on Europe, but in another part of the world they were suffering this this problem and this arbitration tribunal and this international investment treaty from long time ago. Actually, for example, in Latin America, the arbitration tribunal had a lot of war during the 80s and the 90s. So what I want to say is that juridical power allowed to the multinational company to begin in a kind of semi-state with their own legislation. And now I want to talk about what is on the scene to control these transnational corporation activities. And some code of conduct for transnational corporation already exist. For example, we had the tripartite declaration of principle concerning multinational enterprise and social policy by the ILO. We have the OECD guidelines for multinational enterprise, the UN Global Compact. But in general, all these codes are voluntary based on general principle. And even in the last one, there are adherent some of the most denounced multinational companies for human rights violation, like Adidas, Nike, Levi's, Disney, Samsung, Siemens, McDonald's, Nestle, Bayer. So there's clearly a need of a binding code for the multinational companies and a tribunal for justing them. And you were proposing one. You did some proposal from the state. I'm gonna make another proposal from the social movements, because I believe that nowadays we kind of like we have to value the power that this social movement and all the changes that they can make, and all the proposal who are already making. And this social movement and this concentrated in this network of dismantled corporate power, they create an international people treaty on the control on transnational corporation, which was a treaty which was meant an international proposal to international law, and it was carried out for more than 150 organizations, as well as jurists and university professors. And I only have the time to talk about the main proposal. They propose control mechanism on transnational companies to stop human rights violation. They try to generate a framework for exchange and alliance between community and social movement. And they really stand for the adoption of abandoned international negotiation on transnational corporation. And now we are gonna make some question. My first question is related to this table that I show. This table shows some data from the International Center for Settlement and Investment Disputes of the World Bank, and actually it's from your organization, the table. So, and regarding this data, we could conclude that the most of the cases of conflict investor state involve developing countries. If we take into consideration middle income and low income countries, there's the 93% of the cases. What do you think about this fact? And could be this fact showing that the system has been used by transnational companies from developed countries as a way to protect themselves? And don't you think this could entail the development of a new kind of imperialism driven by transnational corporations, as is has already pointed out by some civil organization and government from the global south? That's my first question. And I want to do another question. The European Union agreed to maintain the basis of the arbitration tribunals, as we already said, in the CETA and in the TTIP, though with some modification. Which is the interest of European countries in permitting the system of this kind of private justice when the public justice is meant to be reliable in Europe? Because Germany promoted this kind of tribunal in the FTIP, because they believe that the Pakistan tribunal wasn't reliable, but our tribunal are reliable. So why? And don't this show the real power governing the European Union, that is the transnational corporation? That is just my opinion.
So I guess my question is, are we allowed to be optimistic in this context? This is a sentence that I took from the European Union website, a section about CETA, which is the a trade agreement between Europe and Canada, actually. It says with, CETA or CETI, with CETI, investors will not be able to successfully challenge genuine state regulatory action. The right of governments to regulate in the public interest will not be affected. So actually, this statement kind of proves the contrary of what CETA is all about. So of course, CETA has not been ratified yet, but how could this provision to actually ensure that economic gains don't come at the expense of environment, democracy, and consumer safety. How can this rule with this sentence actually be truly implemented? And is it in CETA? I don't think so, but can this actually be implemented if the other ISDS provisions are still standing? How can this be implemented? Last set of questions. this looks like a framework in which the states are basically just passive recipient of unfair arbitral judgments. So actually, what are the instruments that the state, apart from being bounded to by these treaties, what are the instruments that the governments and state can put forward in this investor states dispute? Apart from, of course, defending public health, environment, and public safety, to have a chance to win the cases, and do they have a chance to win the cases in this system? You've already mentioned this online consultation that the European Commission's actually carried out in 2014, so last year, 2 years ago. And it actually is about the insertion of this investor states dispute settlement provisions in TTIP. So actually there was a huge response, I think over 150,000 responses from this online consultation. And the most hot points or debated points were actually the establishment of a system of appeal, because of course in this provisions it's not envisioned yet. So the creation of this system of appeal, and also another hot point was the protection of the right to regulate that the government has, its sovereignty, its right to protect and govern in favor of their own people. What is the value of these consultations? Will they be actually taken into account in the secret consultations and decision processes for TTIP? Of course, this system, the legitimization for creating such a system in the first place was the assumption that local courts were, like we said, slowed, biased, and corrupted. But is it still the case? Can we still this still be a justification? You have showed that a lot of studies have showed that actually FDI, foreign direct investments, as you said, are not, there is no link between them and actually the implementation of these provisions. For instance, Brazil doesn't have any bilateral investment treaties and still has a huge amount of FDI, incoming FDI. So is this system can still be justified in the light of this? And also, can the states actually have a margin of action and actually pressure pressure the multinational to have the lawsuit settled in its own national courts? Can we implement, I think, Calvo doctrine, where actually national local courts are favored over transnational international ones? Can we implement such a doctrine? Or we can go for the pessimistic view, in which the state's only chance to a fair system is actually withdrawing the withdrawal from the bilateral investment treaties, like Australia did. So is the only solution the abandonment of the system and the withdrawal from this treaties? Okay, thank you.
Thank you for the presentation. Very wide agenda. Answer up to you. You're free to answer to the question you want.
I think I have. And I have the microphone. So, okay. Thank you for the question. If I forget one, remind me. Okay. It is definitely a new, I mean, the title of my presentation was ISDS and TTIP and CETA, so I didn't show you the, and actually, if you look at the world picture, it's true that it's still seven countries that are being sued by a northern investor. So we definitely still have like a neo-colonial agenda, and like you saying, a new kind of imperialism, but it's not just bilateral investment treaties. I mean, transnational companies have a lot of tools at their disposal to actually do what they want in the South, you know. And this is one of them, but there's obviously a lot. But from the beginning, and it's a shame as well, because the EU is actually negotiating a treaty with Mercosur, with Mexico, with Singapore, where the Vietnam, Myanmar, or Burma, whatever you want to say. And there's going to be ISDS, and we don't have such a campaign as we have when it's EU-US, but it did start as a new kind of imperialism. The interest of EU countries, this has always been a big question to me. Why would we go into these kinds of deals? From members of parliaments from the right-wing party, they actually receive a lot of lobbying from bank firms, European service firms, that actually say that when they sue in local US court, because of the judicial system where you can elect the judge in the United States, I'm not super sure that it's like this, but at least that's what they say. That's what the EU lobbyists say, that they actually don't get a fair and equitable treatment. That in US courts, most of the time, EU investors are actually discriminated. And that with ISDS, they can make sure they have a fair treatment. So that's the rationale of big EU companies. And, you know. There's a lot of what else? What the other question? How can state argue to for them? Right? You were asking me this. Well, obviously, what they can say is they can say that they were not discriminating against this particular investor. They were just having a law again. You know, that was applying to all investors. They can just claim for the right to regulate as well. And then the biggest, definitely the biggest argument is about fair and equitable treatment. How do you define fair and equitable treatment? And that's where the state tries to actually argue that it wasn't against a foreign investor, it was just a new law that was here for everyone. With the new system, you'll have an appeal, meaning that the case should only last for 18 months, and then you have the right to appeal. And that still means that you would have 3 years of case, so that still means a lot of money for the arbitration industry, so that doesn't actually solve the problem. When you were talking about the value of consultations, you know, sometimes in EU politics you think, well, they really don't care about what we say, so 97% of people are against and they keep going for it. But actually, I mean, the biggest value is more symbolic. Actually, the Commission and I think Obama thought that this would be finished by now, and it's not. And now members of the European Parliament are asking questions. They have a critical resolution. It's not really critical, but still is critical. And so just the fact that they haven't been able to do what they wanted according to the calendar is already a positive step. It gives us time as well to raise awareness. It gives people time to understand what's the problems. So there is a value in consultation. I mean, you also have to think that the parliament is pretty weak in Europe and it's the only institution that's elected. And you also have to think that the Commission is often blamed a lot when sometimes what it's doing, it's what the member states would like to do, but they can't do in the capitals. The Commission is also under the command of the Council, which represents the 28 member states. So there's also, so sometimes you think they really don't care, but actually they might be pursuing an agenda that someone else has been asking them to do. So, but in true, I mean, they don't listen much, but there's going to be a point when they will have to listen, because TTIP and CETA will both go through the European Parliament. We don't know if they'll go through the national parliaments, but they'll go through the European Parliament. And ACTA, the counterfeit treaty that you might have heard of, actually never went through the European Parliament. So the Commission knows that if there's too much public pressure on the European Parliament, it's not going to go through. So it has to listen. Although it doesn't want to, it has at some point. When you talk about, I mean, I don't think ISDS is a good idea, and South Africa and India, the new treaties that they have now is that you have to have exhausted all the national remedies, so all the national courts until the Supreme Court, until the highest court, before you can start an ISDS claim. And when you start an ISDS claim, you have to prove that you've been discriminated in the national courts. So that's the model that they use now, India and South Africa, knowing that India has a very white wing, you know, prime minister. And so those two countries, it's the new kind of model they would like, which is actually going to kill ISDS, because it's unlikely that after all those procedures, an investor is actually going to go to the private tribunal. I think it is one solution. Another solution would be to actually have a court at the United Nations level that would be public, transparent, and they would, where again you would have to justify that you've been discriminated to have access to it. And then you would have public judges that could decide. There could be a solution. Did I answer all your questions, or more or less?
Maybe they can come back, or can have additional. Can have additional questions.
Can I just? I'd like to, I'm going to add a little bit to what you say, you don't mind, just 5 minutes, yeah? Okay, because I think you pointed to some things that are really important. I want to go back to when you were talking about revolving doors, because I think it's really important. Sorry, I'm going to, 5 minutes, I don't want to talk too much. But the Commissioner for Trade, the person that actually negotiates in terms of you, so there's a head negotiator, Ignacio Barcero, and there's the Commissioner for Trade, Mrs. Malmström. Mrs. Malmström's special advisor is called Jan-Erik Friedman. Mr. Friedman works for a private arbitration firm in Sweden. That's his job, that's what he gets his money for, and he's a special advisor to Malmström. So here again, there's a huge conflict of interest. The head of the TABC that you mentioned, the Transatlantic Business Council, he's called Tim Bennett, and he openly tells everyone that he doesn't understand why Europeans have a problem with genetically modified food. So it's clearly part of the US agenda to have us eat genetically modified food. When you point to 0.5, I think it's important, this figure, because what actually happened is they had the amount of money that we were all gonna win, and then they made an average for the European Union. So it's kind of the idea that we're all going to benefit at some point. Like, we're all equal, you know, in terms of household, in terms of countries, in terms of sectors, which is actually not the case. One of the biggest problems, I mean, there's lots of people that are very pro-European that are against TTIP for this reason, is that it's going to divide Europe even more. Some countries are going to benefit much more than others. The biggest Western countries are going to benefit more than the Eastern countries. And all the trade that's going to go to the States or Canada is actually going to be diverted from the European Union. So some and like other countries, I'm going to lose a lot. Slovenia has done a study that showed it's actually going to lose a job. And then there's an official study in Hungary, but apparently it was so bad that it was never made public. Some sectors are going to lose much more than others. Agriculture is definitely going to be losing. And this is from figures from the US Department of Agriculture. They had a study about the impact of TTIP of agriculture. Actually says that the EU agriculture sector is going to lose. So, you know, some sectors more than others are going to win. And also some parts of society are going to win much more than others, like low-wage workers, people that don't have enough skills to be able to compete. Because if some sectors lose, it means that the people that work in those sectors will have to move to the places and the sectors where they are going to be winning from the deal. And this is not what happens in real life. I mean, you know what happened with the miners in the north of France, in the UK, in Germany. They didn't become bank managers in Frankfurt or in London, right? We all know this. So this kind of idea that we know that in Europe in general we'll win all those jobs and all those money, and then we think that this will just trickle down to everyone in Europe, is actually not the case. I'll quickly speak about regulatory cooperation, because you were talking about what we call non-trade barriers, because one of the thing that really is important with this deal is all about also harmonizing legislation. It's basically for transnational to be able to pick the legislation that they like the most, be in the state that has the best legislation, and then export services, products, without having to change much of what they export. That's really what they want. So at the end of the day, there's an example here. It's AIG, you know, the big insurance company. They actually run the financial products office in London. And the reason why they do this is they got through a regulatory cooperation that was voluntary and informal between the US and the EU governments. They got a deal, the financial deal, for all financial providers in Europe and the EU, that American companies can be in the EU and operate under US legislation. So AIG, when it crashed and it had to be saved by the US government, the US government actually discovered that there was a London office managing the financial products and that they were supposed to supervise it, and they actually never supervised it before. So here what it does, it means ING is in London operating financial products under US legislation in competition with other European banks that have to follow European legislation. So this means that in the long term, European banks in Europe are going to go to Europe and say, guys, ING is here, it doesn't respect the same laws as us, it does more or less what it wants, so please help us. We're in unfair competition. And then it creates competition to lower standards. And that goes back to what you were saying when Malmström says CETA is not going to lower standards. It's true. The treaty itself doesn't lower standards. But it creates a lot of incentive to have competition between standards and to have the lowest one that wins. That's a problem with ISDS, and it's a problem with regulatory cooperation as well. Okay, one last and then I'll stop. All the meetings that we looked at, we asked the Commission for all the meetings that they had with external person. That was from the 1st of January 2012 until March 2014. And 88% of the meetings of DG Trade, so the part of the Commission working on trade, were with external, with private lobbies. And you only had 9% with what we call public interest groups, so NGOs, trade unions. The rest is people that go as people. So there's a clear lobbying here from the private sector, and it's not just the amount of meetings that DG Trade is having with companies rather than with public interest groups. We leaked the financial chapter of TTIP a year ago. When we leaked it, one of the directors of the CTUK in Brussels, so the biggest financial lobby in Brussels, he said he was so close to their brochure that the bystander would have thought it was a copy-paste. And he put this in a blog. So it's not just about they can meet a thousand of lobbyists and still make up their own mind trying to find the public interest. But not only do they meet 88% of private lobbyists, they also copy-paste what the lobbyists tell them, and this is a real problem. One last thing. In the last negotiations in Washington, the person that works the most closely with Malmström, she's called Maria Arsenis, when she flew back from the negotiation in Washington, she didn't fly back directly to Brussels. She did the stopover in London to have an informal lunch with the CTUK to tell them what happened in Washington. flying back from the US negotiations, she goes to the CETA UK before going to her own cabinet to tell them what happened in Washington during TTIP negotiations. It's crazy, and this is now public because we asked for freedom of information request. We saw that they met, and in the the summary of the meeting is, had an informal lunch with CETA UK on my way back, told them what we're negotiating. Okay, do you have any questions?
Okay, so let the floor have the speech. But maybe you know that in France we have a Minister of Economics who come from a bank, and he will probably go back there.
Thank you. My name is Davide, and I would have something like 5 questions, but I will pick only 2. So, in terms of, the first one is related with food security and standards in that sector. So, last week on Wednesday, we went to the European Commission. We talked with one girl that work in the DG of the trade DG. We start to talk about TTIP, but in the end, it didn't seem that she knew what she was talking about. But the point is that she stressed on the point that the European Union is not going to trade anything with the US in terms of food security. And yesterday I read the one paper of your from CEO, and you argue the same. But still, they are still trading. They are still negotiating between the EU and the US. So I'm wondering if you don't think that in the meanwhile they are not the EU is going to change its mind and maybe try to start to negotiate about food security. Then the second question is related with the end, the conclusion of that paper, that article, and basically you said something like the solution is straightforward. This agenda must be stopped. And stopping TTIP would be a wise first step. So my question is kind of naive, but how?
Hi. First of all, thank you very much for this presentation. Yes, my name is Erika. Okay, I apologize in advance for the confusion, but anyway. The treaty with Canada, so every negotiation is over and now it only needs to be ratified by the two parties, and the discussion for the TTIP is still ongoing, so that's okay. What I would like to ask is, from a legal viewpoint, where does this agreement, the one with Canada, stand once it will be ratified? Does it have the degree of a EU treaty? Because as far as I remember, and that was some years ago, if European Union is adopting new treaties, those need to be have to be passed through an approval on a national level. So each national parliament needs to accept them and include them in their own legislation and so on and so forth. So for some countries, this goes only through the national parliament. For some others, you have to have a general referendum. And since, as far as I remember, please correct me if I'm wrong, you need to have unanimity in order to pass these treaties, it has already happened that due to some referendums, some treaties were stopped. For instance, the one on the Constitution for Europe. So I was wondering if you think this can be a possible scenario. And if so, what will be the next movement from the European Union? Because, like most of the time, when you have this strong popular opposition and there is really nothing you can do about it, literally, they always find a way to somehow get these things through anyway. And the second question, which is very naive, I guess, is related to the TTP. So. Okay, basically what Europe says is that this is going to be very good for us because it will increase our trade shares and free trade brings economic growth. So if you do not agree with it, and I think there are plenty of people who do not, I was wondering what can be the other rationale for Europe to support this this treaty, because it seems to be very dangerous and scary. And you have already mentioned that actually the trade tariffs are so low that that's not a reasonable rationale for it. So I was wondering, what, in your opinion, is the real reason why Europe actually wants it? Because it doesn't really make much sense. Thanks.
Hi, my name is Joel, and I wanted to ask you if you can clarify the mechanism by which the judge is picked when an enterprise and when an enterprise sues a country, because in the case, for example, of the Argentinian bonds and the case with the Vulture funds, they are able to use the New York law, because basically the bonds were created under the New York law, but I want to know the difference in these bilateral conflicts. Thank you.
You want to answer?
Yeah, okay. So the treaty, the EU always says it's not gonna affect food safety, but the treaty will have, there's two things that are gonna affect it. I'm trying not to be too, I'm okay. Yeah, two, three. I'm trying not to be too technical, but it's a bit complicated. There's a SPS, so it's sanitary and phytosanitary chapter in the TTIP. The EU position is public, so we don't know. So what you have with TTIP is a bit like in the UN. Everybody comes with their position, and then they agree to it, they do a consolidated text with lots of brackets, and then they try to take away the brackets. So the consolidated text, we don't have it. We don't know what it is at all. But the EU position is now online, so we have some EU positions available online. They're not really up to date anymore, but that's what we have so far. And the SPS chapter of the EU, what it says is, a food product, it will leave a harbor in Le Havre, for instance, or in Chicago. Food will be inspected once they leave the harbor, but they can't be inspected when they enter the harbor. So if it leaves Le Havre and arrives in Chicago, it can only be inspected in Le Havre, not in Chicago again, and vice versa. And here there's a food safety issue. The first one, the one that's the biggest one, you have probably never heard of it, but it's mycotoxins. They're little mushrooms in cereals. The laws in the US are actually higher than the EU. They're carcinogenics. This has been recognized by the World Health Organization, so there's no question about the science behind it. It's carcinogenic, it's just that the levels are different across the Atlantic. Well, the cereals that would leave the US will be inspected under US law, or higher, and then the cereals will be shipped for 3 weeks in a sealed compartment on the sea and get to Europe. Well, the fact that you have cereals in a wet environment for 3 weeks together actually increases the risk of having mycotoxins, but they won't be checked again when they arrive in Europe. So this is an example of not having any change in legislation, but actually having higher risks for food safety in Europe and vice versa in the United States. In regulatory cooperation, which is going to happen before parliaments have a look at legislation, there'll be a dialogue between US and EU regulators. And this dialogue will also be based on the science behind legislation. And this is where the political game would be. Because as you were saying, in the United States, you have to prove that something is dangerous to take it out. In Europe, you have to prove it's safe to put it on the market. So the science, you know, that they're going to exchange is going to be very different, and also there'll be a lot of opportunity for the US government and US companies to actually question the science behind our decisions. So there's a risk for food safety. just to give you an example that might be easier. Bisphenol A, you have them in bottles, I probably know about it. It's banned now in France. You can produce it in France, but you can't commercialize it in France anymore. The United States raised it in the SPS chapter of the World Trade Organization. It didn't understand why France banned it. It's an endocrine disrupting chemical. It means that it gets into your hormonal system and changes your hormonal system. So that's the kind of thing that United States thinks is not acceptable in terms of trade. So can you imagine what's going to happen once there'll be ISDS and what the US is going to think about any country banning a chemical? So it gives you, you know, like, yeah, maybe directly it won't affect food safety, but indirectly it's going to affect it. How to stop TTIP? I think just putting it on the public debate is already a good way of making it stop, because the more people are aware of it, usually the more opposition there is. And then just, you know, there's a European Parliament with members that are elected and are supposed to represent you, or you, most of you, you Europeans. So, you know, just, you know, trying to raise the debate with them and trying to understand what's their position is already creating a huge difference. CETA. So CETA and TTIP are going to be international treaties. So they should be going to national capitals. But at the same time, they're investment treaties. So they're the only competency of the European Union. So there's this two thing here. Is it international treaty? Is it investment treaty? And the European Union and the member states don't know themselves. So what happened is that the Commission sent a question to the European Court of Justice concerning the first deal that it signed. It's the EU-Singapore. So at the end of this year, the European Court of Justice will tell the Commission whether the EU-Singapore is a mixed agreement, meaning that it will have to go through national parliament, or is a sole agreement, so it's only the European Parliament. So we don't know yet if CETA and TTIP will go to national parliaments. And then you see how complicated the EU can be. If it becomes a mixed agreement, it means one country in the Council can say no to CETA and TTIP. If it's a sole competency of the European Union, you need an absolute majority in the Council to kill it. Yeah? So if it's supposed to be something mixed, Greece, for instance, can kill the CETA, which it actually wants because it doesn't protect feta. If it's the sole competence of the Commission, you would need Greece, Spain, Italy, Austria. You'll need a lot of countries together in order to kill it. So we know it'll go for the European Parliament, but we don't know if it'll go to national parliaments. Is it clear? Okay. The Commission always finds a way to get its way through. Yes and no. You have to think that when the Commission started with CETA and TTIP, it was a different European Union than it is now. Meaning, you know, now there's a lot of governments that are actually starting to be against it. There's 51% of public opinion against TTIP and CETA in Austria, Luxembourg, and Germany. And this is according to Eurobarometer, so European figures. So it's going to be hard for the Commission to find a way. What could happen is it gets dropped now, and then it's going to come back in a few years in a different way, which is exactly what happened. What we're talking about here, ISDS, was what they wanted to have in the MIA, Multilateral Agreement on Investment, in the OECD in the 90s. They started to have a campaign in France against it, and Jospin at that time, the French government, pulled out of the agreement, and the whole agreement fell down. So they tried in the 90s through the OECD to get it through. Now they're trying in the Commission. Obviously, there's too much interest to ensure that this doesn't come back at another time in another forum. Okay, what's in here for EU business, no? And the United States system is very different from ours. The states and the cities in the states still have a lot of power. After the 2008 crisis, you had a lot of cities and states that actually would have Buy Local or Buy American Act, meaning that, for instance, the city of Paris will only buy fruits for the canteens that are made around Paris. Or they will only give a contract, water contract, services contract, catering contract, cleaning contract, to a local company to try to have local jobs, to try to, you know, have a local economy that works again, basically. This is something the European companies want. It's a huge market. It's American towns, American cities, it's American states. They want the water, they want the sanitation, the health, the catering. They want a lot out of it that they can't have now. So it's all the public procurement that they want it open to them as well. So there's a huge interest. Services especially, you know, like health, education, postal services, a lot of services are privatized in the US. So again, this is a huge market, like home care for elderly people. There's a lot of things that here are still public that are private there. So EU companies really want this. And the thing as well is, they're going to go there, start new business in new services, and then they can come back to the EU with experience and actually get the market in the EU as well. So it's kind of a way for them to open new markets and try to lobby after to have the same markets in the EU. And the banking sector. And the legislation are nice in Wall Street. Like they want to have opportunity to go to be in the United States and be able to compete under US law with US companies. The way the judges are appointed depends on where the case is put to. So in the ICSID, the World Bank, it's mostly the World Bank that decides. And I think the Argentina case is under the US Chamber of Commerce, the Chamber of Commerce of New York, maybe. This is why it's the rules of New York, and this is why it's probably there, but at this I would have to check. The investor that proposes someone, and that the state can only say yes or no. And after a while, because if the state says no, after a while, it has to pay, because the case keeps going on and on and on. Most of the time, the state will agree to what the investor offers. But there's different cases. There's in the Chamber of Commerce of Paris and one of Stockholm, it's different. So it really depends where the case is settled.
My name is Alessandra. I'm from Brazil, and I actually went online and checked on the. We talked a lot about how Brazil receives FDI, and we don't have any bilateral investment treaties. We actually had 14, but they weren't ratified, thankfully, by Congress. And actually, I read a little bit on what is referred to as a Brazilian model of an investment treaty. It's called the Cooperation and Facilitation Investment Agreement, and Brazil started signing some of these last year with other Latin American countries and the Portuguese-speaking countries in Africa. And they're basically, from what I read, I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more on this. They're proposing alternative dispute resolution methods so that you would be able to rely less on the ISDS. And I mean, I get this because Brazil has some firms that want to invest abroad, but they don't want to, they know that if they sign this agreement, they'll probably lose more than gain with the traditional treaties. And I wanted you to talk a little bit if this is a good alternative, or what are the problems with this? Thank you.
Hi, my name is Javier. Just to make sure, you implied that the financial services industry then is one of the areas being negotiated under TTIP. So just to be clear, so you're saying that an actual like bank or any other financial institution can go and sue the government for implementing a regulation that stands in the way for them to make profits? I mean, is that really the case? And how bad does TTIP and TPP in this case undermine the recent like reform efforts that have been put in place after, you know, the crisis? If you what's your opinion on that?
Hi, my name is Teresa. As I said before, I know about when you were saying about the courts, the international arbitrary courts. I know about this case from Slovakia, which is this health insurance company sued the government since the government decided to nationalize all the health insurance system, the health system in the country. So they also sued them because of future losses that they could have earned. And I don't know, I think from the other examples, I didn't really understand what was the reason for which the companies as Chevron sued Ecuador and so on. But I think I don't know, at least I think it's reasonable for them to sue them because they made an investment and now they're suing because they had to lose it. But in other cases, I really don't know. So I would like maybe if you could explain what's the reasons for them to do that. Thanks.
Okay. Maybe I wasn't clear enough. Brazil, it's not that Brazil doesn't have bilateral investment treaties, it's that it has bilateral investment treaties, but it doesn't have ISDS in them. Sorry, but I don't know about the Brazilian model. I have to look. But it's a good question, I have to look. I'm trying to find the name of this US laws that separate investment banking from Yeah, exactly. And because the US doesn't actually want any threat against this act, from what we understand, but we don't know because we haven't seen TTIP, apparently the US is not keen on having the financial chapter in TTIP. And that's a big thing because basically Europe is saying, we're giving you our public services, we're giving you ISDS, we're giving you lots of things. We want this. They want finance more than anything and public procurement in the US. So that it's a clear threat to this act, and yeah, they could be sued. The US could be sued, but that's why they don't want it. And I think it's quite important to note because you know if the United States doesn't want to open its financial sector and to investment claims, but also just to regulatory cooperation as well, it means that there's a real threat that we're not talking about something innocent. So it's something that Europe wants. The US is not willing to give yet. But the problem with trade negotiation is that you always lose, basically. You lose to win something, it's a negotiation. So we don't know how much Europe is ready to, if they're gonna lose this or not, you know, if what they're gonna give out to the US in order to have a financial sector in TTIP. Slovakia, there's every right for an investor to be compensated from its investment. I mean, I'm not saying that they shouldn't be protected from losing the money that you invest. That applies to an investor, but it applies to anyone. I mean, you shouldn't be threatened to actually lose something that you've invested to. But ACMEA case is that the fact that it was... So ACMEA, which is private health insurance, was going to compete against non-profit health insurance. So Slovakia was trying to reintroduce a public health scheme. So it was giving more portable space for non-profit health insurance, meaning that ACMEA would have to compete with non-profit health insurance. So what ACMEA argued is that it was going to decrease the value of its investment, so they decrease its future profits. So the compensation it asked from the Slovakian government was for future profit. On Chevron, the thing is, there's only international companies at that time that were extracting in Ecuador. So Chevron say this is clearly discrimination, it's against national treatment. This is what Philip Morris was saying in Uruguay as well, because Uruguay only had foreign companies selling tobacco. So it uses a national treatment clause, and it says you're clearly discriminating against foreign investors because this new legislation, this new rule, only applies to foreign investors, and then that's how they sue.
Thank you. Do you have more questions? So just we have two small questions then, because if you have still some energy. I was wondering whether in the US or in Canada there is the same kind of opposition coming from the field. Also in terms of, you insisted on the unfairness, inefficiency, etc. of the dispute settlement system. Is it really different at the WTO? I mean, the trade dispute settlement system, is it more efficient, accountable, or is there a strong difference or not?
So the opposition in US and Canada is actually quite big as well, but the most pressing issue there is the Trans-Pacific Partnership. So the fight has been on the TPP, and so it's Canada, United States, New Zealand, Australia, and Asian countries, Japan, Malaysia, there's a lot of countries. And so there they're focused on this side of the treaty, the Atlantic, the Pacific side, but they're obviously working with us on the TTIP, and it's the same reason, and it helps us a lot as well to work with them, because a lot of the time we hear anti-American or anti-Canadian, because you have to know that the extreme right is actually campaigning against TTIP as well. So, and this is not the message that we want to, when we campaign against it, it's not because we're against anything to do with US and Canada. We just believe people still have the right to have their own regulations, and trade shouldn't be the priority of everything. The new thing now in the United States and Canada, it's actually a sad news, but it's helping us, is that Keystone Pipeline, you know about Keystone Pipeline? It's a pipeline that was going to import tar sands from Canada into the United States. It created a lot of controversy, so much that Obama had to drop it. And now the United States is being sued by TransCanada because Obama has decided to drop it. It's sad because it's a case, but it's useful for Canadian and American campaigners, because then they can use this example and say, look, you have a president that decides to drop something because of public opposition, and now we're going to have to pay a lot of money for this decision by the president. It's the case has just been put now in ICSID, actually, in the World Bank. We'll see what happens, but there is opposition growing. In the WTO, you have a dispute settlement mechanism, but it cannot actually ask for money. It cannot ask for awards or compensation. Because probably what you heard about TTIP, if you type TTIP in Google, you probably have videos about hormone beef, chlorinated chicken, GMOs. This is because these are the three cases of the United States against European Union that are ongoing in the World Trade Organization. It's not because we, those are the cases that we have in the World Trade Organization at the moment. They're not settled. They've been taking a long time, and if they were settled, the WTO can only say, you lost. But it cannot tell the European Union, now you have to pay millions of dollars. And that's the big difference. And it's because it's not working in the WTO that actually governments favor the ISDS, because the money actually does change regulation when the WTO itself doesn't.
Being an activist and try to fighting lobbies, have you never find or maybe how can I say that met some other lobbies from other organizations that try to make some pressure on CEO or on you personally? Because in your website you are pretty straightforward in saying who are the bad guys.
It's actually, I think this is a bit of a cultural divide. It's very Anglo-Saxon, very Dutch, to actually not being scared about saying this company is doing wrong. And maybe I think in Latin countries, I'm French, but in France, Spain, and maybe Italy, we're like, whoa, wow, be careful, you might get sued. We've never been sued so far. We under Dutch law as well, which means it's a bit more difficult for companies to sue us. The libel case, so when if you claim something against a company, they can sue you for libel. They can do this a lot in the UK. In the Netherlands, the laws are quite safe, so it means that so far nothing happened. You have to think that everything that we do is proofread, legally checked. So even if they wanted to sue, it would be difficult for them. What we usually have is there was a report we've just went out on pharmaceutical companies and a public relations agency. The lobbying also happens through, there are lobbying firms basically, but they never say they're lobbying firms. They're public relations, European affairs. They have nice names to basically say we're helping lobbying. And there's a public relations firm that called us 2 days after the report was out to say that they were paid by a pharmaceutical company to proofread all of the reports. And they found one tiny mistake. It was actually in one of the pictures. There was one thing missing. So yeah, they look at what we do, they check it, and anything that we say that's wrong, they're actually going to do their best against it. But so far, there has been, I mean, on me or on us, no, there's been, our coordinator has been followed, and there's been pressure on the dad of one of our campaigners who's been threatened to lose his job because he was actually working for Veolia and we were campaigning against privatization of water. But no, so far nothing has happened against us. We've met lobbyists. It's pretty easy to meet lobbyists in Brussels. You have to go out on the first day in front of the European Parliament. The European Parliament is behind you. There's a whole square. It's closed by the police. It's full of pubs. If you go right, it's more the right-wing MEPs. And if you go left, it's more the left-wing MEPs. We go there sometimes. We meet the lobbyists. We pretend we're someone else. And it helps us to see who has influence and what kind of issue is discussed at the moment in Brussels. But I have friends of mine that I knew before they became lobbyists, they are lobbyists now, and I understand how it works, so no, it's fine. But it's kind of a problem that it's fine in a way, because actually there's no European public opinion. So you can be a lobbyist, be open about it, say what you do and how you do it without having to be scared of anyone. That's what I was saying to you when I was thinking about the blog of the City UK, when they can put a blog and say, look, this is almost a copy-paste of a brochure. Nobody will tell them anything against this. If you go to Halbert and Geiger website, it's a law firm, again, it's lobbyists for hire, and you go to their wins, one of their success, and they're very happy to have killed the directive on plastic bags, which would have banned plastic bags in the European Union. Papier Mettler is a German plastic bag company. They actually went to Halbert and Geiger, paid them to kill the directive. They did it in 3 months, and they're so proud of it. It's on their website. They explain how they did it, who they hired to do it, and how they did it. So there's, they have no one to be scared of. One last example is Pedro Salva. It's a member of the European Parliament from Spain, from the PP. He was caught on camera accepting money to put amendments on the financial directive when he's the vice president of the Financial Committee of the European Parliament. When he went to the judge, he told the judge, I'm sorry. He was caught by a Sunday Times journalist who was actually a really nice blonde girl. He told the judge, I'm sorry, she was too beautiful, I really wanted to sleep with her, I couldn't do otherwise. He was released, and he's re-elected, and he's still today on the Financial Committee of the European Parliament. So, I mean, if they can do this, and nothing happens to them, they don't have to be scared of us, which is the problem. It's the main problem. You probably all know how it works, and you probably know the name of some of your ministers at the national level. Can any of you, does anybody know the name of the commissioner for energy, for instance?
He's a Spanish guy.
Cañete. Cañete, yeah. You see, it's the two people here only know. No. We know very few about exactly what they're doing, what they're working on, and who they are. And because we know little, that's how lobbyists can operate the best they can without having to be scared of anyone. And it's biggest problem. It's why we're there, and it's why we come to universities and we publish on them, and we're so critical. It's because we need to raise awareness. People need to know what's going on.
Right, for sure. Okay. You got more questions? No.
No. No.
Okay. Maybe we can.
It's fine, like, thanks for staying.